In this Introduction to Catalyst video, we'll create our first Catalyst application, examine its structure, and get a basic understanding of how it works. We'll need a working installation of Perl 5.8 or later. I'll be using Strawberry Perl 5.10 on Windows XP. To install Catalyst from cpan, run the command cpan catalyst runtime. We'll also install Catalyst devel, which provides, among other things, a helper script called catalyst.pl. This script creates a skeleton Catalyst application. The installation can take quite a while, so we'll speed it up. While the installation is underway, let's add that the version of Catalyst we're installing is 5.8.0.0.5, released on June 6, 2009. This is just 2 weeks ago at the time of recording this screencast. Catalyst development is indeed very active, with 86 committers to the subversion repository. After the installation is complete, we will run the catalyst.pl helper script to create a skeleton application called tinyurl. This will be our yet another URL shortening application built with Catalyst. Let's take a look at the tinyurl directory structure that catalyst.pl created. The lib directory contains your application's Perl modules. The root directory hosts templates, form definitions, and static files, CSS, JavaScript images, and so on. In a script, we'll find 5 Perl scripts associated with the application. tinyurlcgi.pl runs your application as CGI, not recommended. tinyurlcreate.pl is a helper script for creating models, views, and controllers. tinyurlfastcgi.pl runs your application as fastcgi, the preferred deployment method. tinyurlserver.pl is a development server script, and we'll run this one in a minute. tinyurltest.pl lets you test your application from the command line. The T directory contains a test suite skeleton. 01app.t checks if the application can be loaded. 02pod and 03pod coverage are documentation tests. Makefile.pl enables you to build the application. Notice that Catalyst applications are structured as cpan modules. They are ready for publishing. We then have boilerplate changes and readme files. And the application's configuration file, tinyurl.conf, which for now only specifies the application name. Let's go back to the lib directory. tinyurl.pm is the base module. It specifies which version of Catalyst is the minimum requirement. Catalyst switched to Moose since version 5.8. We inherit our application class from Catalyst and pass some parameters. -debug is a flag to display a debug screen. Configloader tells Catalyst to use the Configloader plugin, which reads the tinyurl.conf file that we've seen before. Static simple is a plugin to serve the static files from the root directory. Below, we define the version number, configure the application, and run it. Next, there is some auto-generated pod that you just have to fill in. There is really no excuse not to document your code anymore. In the tinyurl directory, we have the MVC subdirectories. We have no model and no view for now. In controller, we have root.pm, which handles requests for the root application path. In our example, if we had tinyurl as the domain name, the root path would be tinyurl.com. The root controller inherits from Catalyst controller and defines an empty namespace, which basically means that it handles the root path. The index method does the actual handling of requests for the root path. It has two attributes, path and args, which specify that it matches all paths because there is nothing like /foo after path, and it takes no arguments after the slash. When a request to slash is made, index will send an HTTP response containing the Catalyst welcome message. If an HTTP request doesn't match what index expects, it will be dispatched to default, which returns a page not found message and a 404 error code. At the end of any request, the special method end is called. Let's see how all this dispatching works by running the application right now. To do that, we change directory to tinyurl, and we run from the script directory the tinyurl_server.pl script. This is a development server. Let's take a look at the debug screen, which we enabled with the debug flag before. It shows that Catalyst loaded the config loader and static simple plugins, and that it read the tinyurl.conf file. Our controller class was instantiated, and the actions it defined were loaded. we see index, default, and the path they listen at. By default, the Catalyst development server runs on localhost port 3000. Let's surf there. If we go to localhost colon 3000 slash, we are greeted with the welcome page as expected. If we add a slash foo path, we'll get the page not found error message. Same happens for slash foo slash bar. Let's now go to the debug screen and see what happened. On the debug screen, we can see that we had a request for slash and the index action matched. Then the automatic action end was called. Next, we had a request for foo, which didn't match what index was expecting, that is, no path or arguments, so Catalyst fell back to default. Again, end followed. Same story for foo slash bar. Now let's go back to root.pm and change the attributes of the index method. We'll set path to foo and args to 2. This means that index will be called only if the URL starts with foo and is followed by 2 arguments. We'll also change the HTTP response so that instead of the welcome message, it will just say that it matched the index action. After saving the file, we'll go back to the debug screen, Ctrl+C the server and start it again. This time, if we serve to slash foo slash bar slash buzz, index will match. If we serve to any other URL, index will not match and Catalyst will call the default action. This concludes part 1 of Introduction to Catalyst. We've seen what makes up a Catalyst application and how HTTP requests are dispatched. In part 2, we'll add database access and venture into CRUD.